Okay, Suzuki Katana review, finally making this video so we can talk about this bike. Big news this week with Suzuki releasing that GSX S1000. Bit of controversy with the look of the bike. So essentially that bike underneath the Katana is the same bike as this one, with a few little upgrades. But back onto this Katana. The reason I started the video going into the fuel station, or gas station, whatever you want to call it, petrol station, get used to filling this bike up, because that's what this bike, every time you ride it, you're going to have to fill up. And that's why I've started the video off showing me filling it up. So that's part of the package. You buy this book for the looks, and if you don't like the looks, then you don't buy the bike. Now, why did I buy this bike? I bought it essentially for the looks and just the motor. From my understanding, this motor, K5 motor, has been, I think, a 15-year development. Correct me if I'm wrong. You'll probably get the comments, oh, you don't know fuck all about this bike and that and the history and that. Well, I know bits. I only read snippets of what the history of this engine is. But this inline four, yeah, it's an excellent motor. And the what characteristics of it? It has this phenomenal, powerful wind to it. So it just feels like it wants to pull like a freight train. So let's talk about price, brake horsepower, and in comparison to other bikes. This bike, I paid $15,000 for it. It's at 148 brake horsepower in standard form. Now you compare that to BMW or one of the other powerful bikes in that, you know, that higher brake horsepower range versus this price for this bike. This bike is phenomenal value, but it does come with a few things that I'd probably like to see ironed out. Oh, it looked like the dash just lit up a bit brighter. Okay, so there's a few things that I don't like about this bike. And the number one issue, I'm gonna say straight off the bat, is the damn seat. The seat feels like you're sitting in a pothole. And when I initially bought the bike, I thought I'd be clever and change the seat. I took it to an upholster and I thought, oh yeah, let's add some foam to the seat and see if that'll make it more comfortable. But the problem was that the upholster, he added way too much foam than what I liked, and he made the seat look like a pillow, and then that made the bike lose the lines of the bike. So the way this bike's designed, it's got sharp lines. So when you look at the seat has the lines of the seat going lines with the plastic fairings. So as soon as you alter the seat on this bike, it looks horrible. So I've kept the seat, and that could be used for long distance kind of touring rides, but then there's an issue with that. And when the upholster did change my seat, there was no way of me reverting back to fixing it. He put that many staples in it that it pretty much cock-blocked me from trying to fix it. So I was forced to buy a new seat. But the bonus was that this new seat that I got was the Katana seat, which has the red highlights and the carbon fiber looking strap. So with my little cheat sheet where I add stickers to the bike to protect it from scratches. So you've seen in previous videos where I got the KTM and I bought some of that fake carbon fiber stickers. I've added it to the side of the bike where you actually grip it with your legs to protect the paint. And I kind of use that style through across a number of my bikes, a cheap way of adding some sticker protection to your bike. So apart from the seat being absolutely horrible, I wish Suzuki kind of would try change that a little bit, but it's too late now. Whoever did the testing of these bikes, they really f***ed up. And I'm not the only one. I've seen one other rider with this bike, and the funny thing is, the first thing I noticed on their bike was that that seat thing that you can add onto your bike. I've got a memory block of what it is. It's got the air thing, air hawk. So the other that I've ever seen existence in Australia so far had an air hawk on the seat, and that made me laugh. And I'm not the only one with this issue. So let's add to that issue where it the other thing is with these handlebars, they felt that they sat too low. I mean, I've added on this handlebar a riser, SW Tech Motec riser, and that riser's just lifted it up a little bit. And because this bike, when you're sitting on it, it feels, after you've been on it for half an hour, you feel like you're a bit out. And that's another issue with this bike. But I've kind of minimized it with the bar risers, and that kind of affects the look of the bike a little bit too. But you're doing whatever you can to make the bike just that little bit more comfortable. So comfort, yeah, it's not the most comfortable bike. And all those YouTube videos that reviewed this bike, comfort, they threw out the back door. So that's one thing that's really annoying about this bike. But overall, it makes you smile how kick-ass it is for what it is. I personally love the looks of the bike. It has that 80s retro look. I'll probably might even try squeezing with this in this video what it's like to ride at night, because when it lights up, the lights are excellent and lights up the ground. It looks like a spaceship. Other bonuses, let's talk about this bike. Okay, mirrors, I wish they could change the mirrors a bit. What's this? It's real dorky where they just come up here like that. I wish it was a CNC piece like the KTM 890. Those mirrors would probably go well on this bike. Let's talk about the dash. So the dash is pretty much like your Casio watch. It's an 80s style dash, really, for what it is. Personally, after seeing what Suzuki did with the new Hayabusa, that Hayabusa dash on this bike, well, it's probably a bit too big, but that would look sick on this bike. It would absolutely look phenomenal. So that's one thing that I'd love to see on this bike, but it is what it is. Now, I am in the process of going today and getting an inquiry and seeing how much they can get the screen added to this bike. I see what the price is. I know it's $259 on the Suzuki website. I'm wondering if I can get it cheaper through the dealer with a dealer membership discount. So when you buy a bike, they usually give you a discount. So I'll find out today and see what they offer it, and hopefully I can get that ordered. Now back to the fuel. I believe, yeah, this fuel tank, you get about 225 kilometers to a tank. I thought that I could ride the snowy mountains easily on this bike. Now, and as a kind of sports tourer bike, boy was I wrong. Three times I nearly ran out of fuel, and I had the fuel light on, and I was running on vapor as I got into towns. So that's another thing with this bike. It was a massive failure with the fuel tank design, and someone in Suzuki should have stepped on and said, "Nah, we can't accept that for that size bike. For that size engine, we'll go no less than this required amount of liters for the bike." There you go, so design. Now the design of the rear hugger on this bike, absolute horrendous. It didn't, for if you're gonna use in the 80s, they didn't have, well, when the original Katana came out, they didn't design the bike to have a rear hugger. So essentially, they should have said, no, the design department, whatever, the guy that had the idea to put that hugger on the bike with the number plate and that, they should have said, no, that's a Katana. Nah, it doesn't go with the bike. So I've removed mine, and you would have seen the video where I've used the mustard tail tidy to change the look of this bike. But the draw card is, once you remove that hugger, the two ugly bolts on the rear swing arm, and it looks absolutely horrible. And it would have been probably a good option if you could order the bike without it. Traffic wise for this bike, let's talk about Sydney traffic and riding this bike. It's a very manageable bike to ride in traffic. You can lane split with it, and it's quite nimble for being a leader bike. There's certain places in Sydney roads where it's just too tight for me to lane split, but probably 80% of the time you get away with it. Okay, I'm just gonna shut my mouth a bit for this. I don't like being next to people talking. And that's how you lane split with the big boy. So 203 kilos I believe this bike is for weight wise, and I just showed you how easy it is to lane split. Suzuki paint. Okay, the paint on this bike, you have to see it in person. So yeah, Suzuki blues, I loved Suzuki blues, the sparkle. The black's just as nice. The sparkle in this paint in the sunlight is excellent, and I've got to give credit where credit's due for Suzuki for doing that, for having nice paint on their bikes. And the reds, the red is a gorgeous, bright, vibrant red. So it is a toss-up to choose which bike. Do you ever go with the silver or the black? Now, I had the opportunity to buy this in silver, and I nearly did. There was a demo of this bike, but when I saw the guy that rode the demo of the bike, he was a big boy. And I thought, there's no way I'm going to buy a bike that's been demoed with that guy riding on it. Poor thing. The dude was probably easy. He was 150 kilos. He was the biggest unit I've ever seen riding to break in a bike. And I thought, no, I won't touch that bike. So this bike here is a demo, and it had about 150 k's on it when I purchased it. So instead of buying this bike originally when they came out, $18,999, around that price range, I bought this for $15,000 with 150 k's on it. The only thing there I got stung was that Suzuki dropped the price by $3,000 not long after I purchased this bike. Now, not that I was going to sell the bike. I am really going to enjoy it for a good 15,000 k's. I was a bit annoyed that how much the price dropped. Suzuki, just put your prices in and don't, you know, devalue the bike so much. Okay, throttle response and low speeds. This bike can be jerky. For me, it's a non-issue. People that ride this bike, or people that generally ride Suzukis, they tend to get really sooky about the throttle and low speeds of this bike. There's a technique to riding these bikes, and that is put your foot on the back brake when you go around roundabouts and just rev it, and you'll minimise that jerkiness. Let's move on from that to the gearbox. Hands down, Suzuki make the best gearboxes. You watch this, low speed, oh, I'm not going to lane split. I can pop, see, straight into neutral. There you go, I'm in neutral. Every time I can get into neutral with this bike. And even from day one, I've never had issues. As we're KTM and Husqvarna bikes, I'm sitting at the traffic lights, rocking the bike back and forth, trying to get it into neutral. Now, I apologize for the audio to be not the best. The helmets that I have, I've been a bit cheap, and this is a cheap Bell helmet. And if the audio is whooshy, my apologies. I do have to upgrade and get a helmet, a better helmet, especially recording videos. So here we go on the TACO, it's saying 199 kilometers till empty. This bike, yeah, so far I've done 5,949 kilometers. In static, when in traffic, when the bike has stopped, it does heat up to the 101 degrees temperature, and you'll hear the fans kick in. And when the bike's getting that hot, I'm not a fan of being stuck and letting the bike run that hot. Well, it'll do it, but I'm not a fan of it. Especially in Australia, they just, yeah, the moment you, the better you get moving with the bike and get the oil through it, it's better. Oh, this bloke. Now, I've done this review, I've come this way, just a little bit of kind of traffic riding, just to show how this bike goes. Watch this, neutral straight away. Now, try and remember if there's anything else I need to talk about this bike. Oh, okay, braking. Braking on this bike. Yeah, they upgraded the front to have Brembos, and the rear is a Nissan. I believe it's a Nissan. N-I-S-S-I-N type rear brake. The stopping power of this bike feels like it's a bus. It doesn't grip, and it's a slow type braking. Yeah, factor in ABS and stuff like that, but the brakes, personally, I feel that they need more stopping power, especially for the weight of this bike. There's the Popo. Should go lean split next to him. I was going to do this review and take some photos and just do that little photography thing with the bike, but I'm just not organized. I forget what tyres I've got on this bike from standard. I'll have to have another look at them. But the bike tyres that came originally from day one have been pretty good. I've had no real issues. But my favourite tyres are the Michelin Pilots, and they're up to version Pilot 5, is it now? I used to get the Pilot 4s that have that compound, so you don't get that flat spot on the tyre from doing highway riding. You get a bit more extra life out of your tyres. So essentially, when these tyres go, I'll be getting the Michelin Pilots on it. Now, I do have the stock exhaust on this bike. That's another thing. I haven't changed the exhaust. I'd like to get a Yoshimura full system done. I just, yeah, money. Money's the thing, so. And the last thing that I do want to get done on this bike, yeah, I did order a cane and air filter. And that air filter, I was going to do a video and put it in until I opened up the actual booklet, the service booklet, and seeing that this was an absolute pain in the backside. Pain in the backside to put the air filter in. All the fairings have to come off and the fuel tank has to come up. And I thought, well, when I get that booked in for a service, I'll get them to do it. So this concludes the Katana review. If you've got any questions on that, I'll make another video and I'll put something together. So here's my mate's house. So here we go, guys. I might do a quick walk around and you can see the bike in all its glory. See, look at this, low speeds. Oh, a bit rough then. Oh. That was a bit rough. This bike's meant to have a low speed assist, I think. And we're off. Oh. Isn't she a beast? Okay, peace out, guys.